Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our fifth and final night of Vacation Bible School, our VVBS, Virtual Vacation Bible School. And as we said last night, maybe you just joined us tonight for the first time, or maybe last night was the first time. But one of the things we realized a couple nights into this was if you're behind, you can go back and binge watch all the way up until now. And so we encourage you to catch the first night through tonight. And one thing you can do if you're binge watching or watching anything that's recorded is when we mess up, you can just skip that part. And one of the things we did last night is I messed up. I know that Jerry cannot believe that we messed up. I forgot the opening song. So I don't know how we even got started when I forgot the opening song, but we're going to start with Concrete and Cranes. So let's stand up, Raiden, and let's do the opening song. Having a wonderful time with our construction theme this week and our thoughts about foundations. And one of the foundations of Vacation Bible School through the years, as long as I've been coming to Vacation Bible School, are the pledges. And we always like to thank God for the country we live in, the freedoms that are afforded to us here to worship without fear. So we're going to have the Pledge of Allegiance to the United States flag. Attention, salute, and pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, now we're going to pledge allegiance to the Christian flag. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood uniting all Christians in service and in love. All right. And now we'll have the Pledge of Allegiance to the Bible. Attention, salute, and pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Bible God's holy word, and will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, and hide its words in my heart, that I may not sin against God. All right, great job, guys. We've had some great pledge leaders here in our core group this week, and they have done a great job of helping us do the pledges. So now we're going to do our motto, and we've been shouting out the motto nice and loud. We've heard people from Alabama. We've heard people from Adairsville. We've heard a lot of people from a long way away shouting the pledge. So we want to see if we can hear you shout it out tonight, wherever you are. So let's say it with a nice, strong, loud voice on the count of three. Help me count. One, two, three. Jesus, our strong foundation. And that motto comes from our scripture passage of the week. And we're going to say the address, and then the scripture, and then the address again. So here we go. Philippians 1:6. I am sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Philippians 1:6. All right, and you may be seated, and tonight we're excited to have our fifth and final lesson as we're thinking about tonight the foundation of life that God has given us, that God has allowed us to be reborn so that we can live an abundant life now, an eternal life with him forever. And one of the things I love about Vacation Bible School every year, and this year has been no different, is that it incorporates so many different people in the church. The church is the body of Christ, and we're the spiritual building of Christ. But sometimes, even as the pastor, I don't get a great opportunity to see people doing all the different roles they do on a Wednesday or a Sunday morning or a Sunday night. But during Vacation Bible School, we kind of get to experience it differently and together. And so I've been so excited and impressed, and God's just letting me have a personal revival, seeing so many people teach and do things they do every week, so they're not maybe thinking this is special, but I don't always get to hear them teach. I don't always get to see them lead in this way, so it's blessed me. So I hope it's blessing you, and tonight we're going to see another one of our teachers and listen and hear from another one of our teachers in the church. Brother Joseph Williams is going to come and teach us. So y'all encourage him, okay?
Good evening, everyone. How is everyone tonight? Good. Awesome. That's great to hear. Y'all remember what we briefly went over last night, our story was about? What was the promise that Jesus made to us last night? Y'all remember? Yeah, he died on the cross in our sin, but the end of our story, he made one promise last night. Yeah, that was true. But that Jesus will never leave you. He'll always be there with you all of the time. So tonight we're going to learn about sand, and we're going to learn about rocks. And do y'all know what sand and rocks make? Yeah, it makes a type of foundation. And the point of our story tonight is Jesus is the foundation of our life. So what I want y'all to get out of this more than anything, when you put your faith in Christ, no matter when storms may come in your life or troubles may come in your life or things happen in your life, if your faith is rooted in the right foundation of Jesus Christ, guess what? He's going to help y'all get through anything that comes your way. So some of you out there are older. Some of you out there are as young as me. Some of you have been through some storms in your life, but I know when you put your faith in Christ, you will see it. Get through it. Tonight, our message is found in Matthew 7:24-29. So if you out there, you have a Bible and you want to turn to that, you can. I'm going to read it from our book that we have for this week's Vacation Bible School, though. It said that Jesus began telling the crowd that everyone who heard the words he spoke and acted on them would be like a wise man who built his house on the rocks. The house had a strong foundation so that when the rains fell and the rivers rose and the winds blew against it, the house did not collapse. However, those who heard Jesus' word but did not act on them would be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. His house did not have a strong foundation, so when the rains came and the rivers rose and the winds blew against the house, Guess what happened to the house? It crashed. It all crumbled in. So Jesus is teaching, amazed the people that were listening to him, and Jesus told parables to help people understand exactly what he was trying to explain to them. So what are some of the things in your life, when you think about it, have been some times that you've been on shaky sand? And I want you to think, if you ever, were you fully trusting in Jesus at that point when you came across those times in your life? I know there's been times in my life when I thought, how in the world did I get myself into the situation? And I didn't know what end was out. But I know when I went to prayer with God that he always seemed to have the answer for me. And that's the thing. God will always have the answer. But you're not going to get it unless you go to him. So I'm going to have Miss Debbie come up, and we're going to see what y'all know about foundations. Okay? She's going to set up two things. Debbie, you're going to have to come over here because I want everybody to see it. So if you'll bear with us just a second. So I want to ask y'all a question. In our story tonight, Jesus said that we would have to make a decision about something, okay? And we heard about the strong foundation, the guy who built his house on the rock, and we heard about the foundation where the guy built his house on the sand. Which house do y'all want to live in? The one that's built on rock. I do too, because I don't want my house collapsing in around me and everything. So we're going to show you or give you some examples. I'm going to ask you some questions about what a strong foundation actually looks like in your lives, not just as the parable teaches about a house, but what it looks like in your life. So I got a couple questions for y'all to answer. And we're going to see if we can build a strong foundation real quick based on some kind of basic principles. So do you think that reading the scripture on a regular basis is part of a strong foundation or a weak foundation?
Strong.
Strong, yeah. So this is our sand, and this is our strong foundation. So since you said that's part of a strong foundation, Debbie's going to put a block on the strong foundation. So going to church and serving, do you think that's a strong foundation or a weak foundation?
Strong.
Okay, so good. We got two blocks on strong foundation. Blaming a mistake on someone else.
Weak.
Weak. Sandy foundation. Yeah, so all right, there we go. We're getting there. Showing respect to your parents.
Strong.
Strong. Y'all all show respect to your parents all the time, right? So we're going to learn about building this foundation and being respectful of our parents. How about being on an inappropriate website? Any of y'all surf the web, look at cable TV or anything like that? It could be anything. So don't just think the internet, think, right? It's anything that's in your life that you really shouldn't be doing. It's a weak foundation, you're right. How about telling the truth? Strong foundation, you're right. How about staying quiet when somebody's being bullied? Weak. That's right. It is weak. We always need to do what's right. Christ, we need to tell the appropriate person if there's something going on. All right. How about cheating on schoolwork? Weak. Man, y'all are good at this, which is a good thing. It tells me you know what's right and wrong. How about including a new student?
That's good.
That's real good. That's right. All right. And then, how about spreading rumors about fellow classmates? Okay, that's weak. Stand it back up. Get it on there. We hadn't seen the wind come yet. How about spending many hours on a computer game instead of doing your chores? Weak. Okay. Taking something that isn't yours?
No, weak.
Weak.
Guys, you're getting ahead of me.
Fine.
We're
going to
read this.
Okay. Now, then finally, how about praying every morning and every night and praying without ceasing?
Strong.
Strong. That's right. It's a strong foundation. So, now, In our story tonight, we heard about the rains coming, the winds blowing, and all this, and the strong foundation. So, Logan, can you come up here just a second? I just want you to kind of hit the table. Not hard, just hit the table. Okay. Do it one more time, Logan.
Wait, there it goes.
Oh, okay, good. All right, Logan. So, as you can see in our demonstration, I try to use, like they use the sand, but think about a sandcastle when you've been, any of y'all been to the beach, and you build this nice, beautiful sandcastle. And a lot of y'all probably have. I have too at one time. And the waves, they just keep coming, right? They never stop. Well, the waves is like life keep coming at you every day. And life will continue to come at you, whether it's good, whether it's bad, whatever it may be. If you have Christ in your life, you're going to continue to fend those off, and you're going to push that back. But when you don't have Christ in your life, those waves, it takes just a little bit of time at your house. It takes a little bit of time of your life, and it just keeps building and building and building. Guys, the decision y'all have to make tonight is, are you going to trust in the sayings of Jesus? Are you going to put your full faith in Him, and are you going to surrender your life to Him? Because if you don't surrender your life to Christ, those waves are just going to keep beating and beating and beating on your house and on you until it finally you're going to get to a point in your life where you're going to say, I just can't do it. So instead of waiting and so long to put your faith in Jesus, there's no time like tonight. He already promised, we saw through the previous promises, God will never leave us. He'll never forsake us. We know that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of the Lord. But we also know that we have a gift. And all we got to do is reach out and take it. All we got to do is say, well, John 1:12. Many is called on His name. All you got to do is call on the name of Jesus. And He is faithful to come into your life and forgive you of all your sins. So, that's my lesson for tonight. I hope y'all enjoyed it. I just want to leave you with one thing. God loves you no more yesterday than He did today. He loves you the same every day, day in and day out. He's always there for you. You just got to give yourself to Him. Coming up next.
What do you mean now? What are they doing? All right. So tonight we're going to talk about staying connected. Why do you think we'd have to stay connected? So what Miss Abby has here is a map. And we're going to pretend that Logan is sitting right here in the state of Georgia at VBS. And he wants to tell somebody way over here in California about Jesus. How's he going to do that? So what Miss Abby's going to be doing while we're talking is we have one domino here that represents Logan, and he's the Christian. He's holding the cross. And we have the other domino here that is the little boy out in California that Logan wants to share the gospel with. So you guys tell me, how are you going to do that? How are you going to share the gospel? So how are you going to connect in and share the gospel? Let's say back there in the back. See, everybody turn around and look at Georgia. She's sitting back there on the very back row. How would we get the gospel back there to her? How would we do it?
Lie?
No. What? Fly on a plane to the back of the church? What if you told Miss Delilah? What if Miss Delilah turned around and told Mr. Jerry? Mr. Jerry told Ronnie. And it keeps going on. Do you think eventually it would get all the way back there to Georgia?
Yeah.
Why? How do you think it works that way?
Because people tell.
Because I tell somebody and they tell the next person, right? So do we know that? We don't even know that kid out in California, right? But we can be a part of sharing the gospel with them, just like if they were sitting in the very back of the room, just like Georgia is. So what Abby's doing here is she's arranged. That was what we were going to do. She's arranging some dominoes. And so we're going to use those dominoes to represent this. So what do you think would happen if Miss Abby doesn't put one of the dominoes in here? It's not going to make it, right? Because why? Yeah, what if that last person, what if we got it all the way back to Miss Ronnie? And then she said, I'm not taking part in this. I'm not telling. What would happen to our chain reaction? What would it ever make it back to Georgia? No, because she said, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to share the gospel. I'm too afraid. I'm too scared. People will laugh at me. Somebody might say something to me. People will think I'm weird. People will call me a Jesus freak. But what is our... What is our calling? What is our calling? What are we supposed to do? But what's the first job of a Christian? To learn. But then what do we have to do? After we learn, what are we supposed to do? Believe. And then we have to share, right? So if I learn about the gospel, but I keep it inside my heart and I never share it with anybody else, and I'm the only person who knows about it, will the rest of the world ever learn? Nope, they will not. Miss Abby's going to do it this time.
I am.
Okay. That's my Abby. That is Abigail. She is going to got it going on. Now, here we go. Is it going to go all the way? All the way. Yay. Good job, Abby. So, in order for us to, for the gospel to travel from person to person, everybody has to stay connected, right? So, we have some hand sanitizer up here because we are going. So, sanitize your hands. We are going to come up here and do a little bit of hand holding here in a minute. So let's get them all good and dry. So in order for us to share the gospel, everybody has to stay connected in the circle. If Miss Abby had pulled one of those dominoes out, the falling of the dominoes would have stopped with that last person, right? Because they can't jump the hole. So what we're going to do now is once our hands, or has everybody got their hands sanitized? All right, let's come up here. All right, so let's everybody come up here. There you go, Abby. All right. So we are going to all get connected. We're all going to hold our hands because we're all sanitized. All right. So Miss Abby is going to hand one person an energy stick. It doesn't matter. You're going to get one in and he's going to get one in. All right, so let Miss Abby in the hole. All right, Abby, you going to take us from here or you want me? All right, so if we have a break in our connection, we have no energy. We've lost our current. The gospel's not flowing from person to person to person. But as soon as we, what are we doing? So hold the stick up. All right. Hold it up. Hi. Okay, so Logan let go of, break the connection. Make the connection back.
Why did you do that?
So it's just like sharing the gospel. As long as we all do our job and we all stay connected and we're all passing the message from person to person to person, then we have fulfilled that commandment that we're supposed to take the gospel to all the corners of the earth, right? But when one of us lets go, the current stops. Here, let look. I think it's maybe the hand sanitizer. So now we got two. So the more, so we could join everybody in the room. We could have everybody in the room, but if one person lets go and stops the reaction, then the energy sticks, the current no longer flows between them. So we lose our gospel current. So we want to keep our gospel current going, right? And how are we going to do that? We're going to share the gospel. You guys are going back to school next week, and you are going right back into the mission field, right? So you invite kids to church. Invite adults to church. Okay?
Good job.
All right.
Thank you.
We'll play with them afterwards, okay, Logan? Now we're going to do a song.
This is our last night as Excavator Missions. We've been talking a lot about how Jesus is our strong foundation and how he loves us. He's never going to leave us. He keeps his promises. And we're important to him, aren't we? We matter to Jesus. He also does something really special for us, and that's he forgives us of all of our sins. So tonight we want to focus on how Jesus should be the foundation of our lives. A strong foundation is what holds us together, and it keeps us from leaning in the wrong direction. You remember that tower that was leaning? All right. We're reminded in our story tonight that we need to build our lives on a solid rock, not on the sinking sand, right? And we can do that. We can build our lives on the solid rock by listening to stories and by reading our Bible and memorizing scripture and remembering the things that we've learned in Vacation Bible School this week. If we don't do those things, what happened to the house in Debbie's demonstration? If we're not doing any of the really good, solid foundation things, you remember what happened to the house? It just fell down. That's right. So without Jesus as our strong foundation, we can crumble too. And that means we can give in and begin to do things that we really shouldn't be doing and thinking things in our heads that we shouldn't be thinking and watching things on TV that we shouldn't be watching. But with Jesus, we can be strong and we can be bold and we can know that we're going to always be safe in His care. So tonight, let's make our last trip to Italy and we'll see what the Worthy family is doing. And I want you to watch carefully because they're doing something pretty special, and there are four things I want you to pick out that were instruments that originated in Italy. So watch carefully.
Part of Italian life. Almost everywhere you go in the city, you hear street musicians play amazing music. The most famous music theorist of the Middle Ages, Guido Monaco d'Arezzo, was born right here in Arezzo. He is the inventor of the modern musical notation, Do, Re, Mi. And this is actually his house.
Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Ti.
Nice, Ben. Also, you can thank Italians for helping to invent the guitar, organ, violin, and piano.
Our family works with a lot of volunteer teams that come from America.
And these volunteer teams love Jesus, and they want to share that love with the people they come in contact with.
These groups do all sorts of things like teach English camps, sports clinics, music classes, anything that they can do to build relationships with Italians and eventually be able to tell them about Jesus. My favorite thing to do is what we call store-to-store ministry. That's when volunteer teams go from store to store, visiting people who work there, and try to start a conversation about Jesus. When they have made a friend, they'll come back with a local believer who will share the gospel with them.
The store-to-store outreach has been a really awesome way to share Jesus with Italians. Italy is a beautiful place with a rich history and a wonderful place to live. But there are a lot of lost people here who need to know that Jesus loves them and He wants to have a relationship with them. And that's why we are here.
There are people all over the world that need to know about Jesus, maybe in your hometown or neighborhood. We want to encourage you to reach out and make friends with those around you. And who knows, maybe you will get an opportunity to tell them about the love of Jesus. Please pray for us and we'll pray for you. And remember, as we say in Italian, Gesù ti ama, Jesus loves you. Ciao.
Wow, can you say Gesù ti ama? Gesù ti ama, that means Jesus loves you in Italian. So now you can go home and tell your mom and dad, Gesù ti ama. And they'll say, what? And you'll say, Jesus loves you. So what did you learn in the video is a really big part of life in Italy? Music. We love music here too, right? What were the four instruments that we saw that originated in Italy, Harley? What was the other one? An organ, that's right. So we have people here in our church that play piano and guitar and violin, but I'm not sure if we have anybody that plays the organ. We don't have an organ here, do we? So music is one way that you can talk to people and strike up a relationship with people, just like you saw on the street with the street musicians, and begin to tell them about Jesus' love. Another way that they're spreading the good news is similar to what Jorge is doing in Puerto Rico, and they have volunteer groups that come in, and they spread across the city, and they held English camps, teaching people how to speak English. They had sports camps. They had music classes, a lot of the same things that we do here. So here in our country, where can we find people that need to hear about Jesus? Where could you find somebody, Raiden, that needs to hear about Jesus? In jail. There are people that go to the jails and do a jail ministry. That's right. What about you, Olivia? At school? Yes, but there are people that go to the jail to tell the people who are in jail about Jesus. That's pretty cool. So no matter where you are, what you're doing, are you going to start school this year, Logan? What grade are you going to be in? Kindergarten? You can talk to your friends in your new classroom, can't you? And I know that you're on a running team, right? Can you talk to your running mates about Jesus? And Raiden, you do something too. You swim, don't you? What about your swim team mates? But could you talk to your friends at lessons about Jesus? Sure could. So, now let's join up with Jorge Santiago in Camarillo, Puerto Rico, and let's see what we're going to find out about Jorge tonight.
Jorge Santiago was born in Camarillo, Puerto Rico. After living in Washington, D.C. for a few years, he moved back to Camarillo to start a new church in his hometown.
Our original plan to start the church was going to be in summer 2018, but I guess that was not God's plan.
That's because Hurricane Maria hit Puerto Rico 2 years earlier, and Jorge and his family started to help people who had no food, no water, and sometimes no roof over their head.
We just start serving the people and loving into people. And through that, God was working through that to start his church.
So, Jorge started One Church Camarillo almost 2 years earlier than he had planned. And along the way, the church teamed up with Send Relief to help people who are still trying to recover from the storm.
People see that One Church Camarillo is giving back to the community and is investing money, resources, effort, and the image that One Church Camarillo is that we represent hope for them.
More than 2 years later, Jorge and his church have their own building. They are still meeting needs and baptizing new believers. They even had a big vacation Bible school for the kids. Jorge says no matter how old you are, God has a special plan for you, just like Jorge.
How can you be involved in mission at your school, in your community, with your neighbor, and bring them to the church? You never know what God is going to do through that.
So do you have to go all the way across the ocean to tell somebody about Jesus? No. Where do you go? The community. When you go right outside that door tonight, there's a whole community of Redbud and Calhoun that needs to hear about Jesus. And we have several groups that do that, and you may have even been part of those groups when we help fix food in Go Ministries, or when we take food to children on Wednesday nights, and some of the other missions opportunities that we've done in the past, like backpack ministries. And we pack shoe boxes, don't we? So you've been able to participate in those things. So do you remember where Jorge moved to when he left Camarillo? Washington, D.C. Why did he come back? Because he wanted to start a church. He heard God's voice telling him to start a church, and he had to start that church earlier than he had planned to because of the hurricane that came. But what did he say his church represents to the people of Camarillo? Hope. His church represents hope to them. Not only do they provide spiritual things that you need in here in your heart, but they also met the people's needs in helping them repair their homes and get their electricity turned back on and putting roofs over their heads and giving them food to eat. And sometimes that's the best way to reach somebody, is if they have a need, is to meet that need first and then start talking to them about Jesus. So we might not be able to bring people here to our church right now because of all the virus and stuff that's going on, but what are some ways that we're taking our church out to the community? Something that you can see on your phone. Virtual. We're using Facebook, aren't we? That's right. What about our parking lot? We still have cars that drive, people drive up here on Sunday mornings, and they sit in the parking lot and they listen to our church services. So even if you don't come through the doors, our message can still go out the doors in lots of different ways. And you're the most important way that that message gets out there. So what I want to do tonight is for us to pray one more time for the missionaries. Because remember, the Worthy family said, please pray for us and we will pray for you, right? So let's do that. Let's bow our heads. God, we're so thankful for the week that we've had in Vacation Bible School. Thank you for all who have attended in person. Thank you for all those who have watched online. And we ask that you continue to provide blessings on the Worthy family and on Jorge Santiago in their service to the people of Arezzo, Italy, and Comorio, Puerto Rico. And we, Lord, we want you to be pleased with their work and bless their work and protect them, Lord. Give them safety. We love you and we want to serve you. Amen. Guys, thank you. All right, Mr. Bryant.
All right. How are you? Good. All right, this is our last night, right?
Yeah.
We'll be sort of down after this. We'll have any fun, will we? Toilet paper. I know we've had this pandemic, and I know this was a very big commodity several months ago. People were fighting for this stuff. I think it's sort of calmed down now because I think there's a lot of it out there. You can get it, you know. Just make sure it's not used. But anyway, we're going to play a little game tonight that I used to play during field day with the kids in elementary school. And they really loved it because I need three volunteers. Would you come up, please? Three volunteers. Come on up. You volunteer. Thank you so much. Actually, I voluntold you, so very good. Give me five. Clean. We're clean. We're clean. Don't knock Logan down. Okay. All right. This is our toilet paper game. And you can do this at home. It's real easy. Make sure you don't go in and take the one that's on the thing in the bathroom. Because I'd hate to go in the bathroom and there not be any toilet paper to be able to be used. So just go and ask for a roll of toilet paper, or two, if possible, because you can make a competition out of this. And we're sort of going to have a little fun with it tonight for just a minute. So what we're going to do is we're going to ask Olivia to be our volunteer person to do this, okay? So, Olivia, come on up here. You stand right here. Smile. Say hi. All right. Good deal. All right. You guys get on each side of her. One over here. Logan, you come over here. You face her. Turn around and face her like this. There you go. Now, what's going to happen is we are going to see how fast we can wrap Miss Olivia up in toilet paper. Okay? So, what we're going to do is I'm going to give you the roll. Okay? And you got to be easy now. You got to hold it. Just hold it right here. You can make a race out of this. You can have four people. And you can make a race to see who can wrap somebody up and use all the toilet paper. It looked just like a mummy, okay? So we're going to see how fast we can do this, all right? Now, Logan, he's going to wrap it around the back. You're going to take it and pass it around the front, okay? And then he's going to take it, and we're just going to keep going. And you want to go up and down her body, okay? On your mark, get set, go. Uh-oh, it broke. That's why you got to be real careful. Let's try it one more time. Just pass it around. Now you take it, Logan. All right, Logan, you pass it to me. I'll help you. All right, we'll roll it around. Oh. This is not the industrial grade, I'll tell you that. It wouldn't be tearing at all. All right, Logan, you take it. Hurry. Here we go. Don't flinch, but you'll make it break. Logan, you take it. Give it to Logan. All right. Oh, we'll do it again. Here we go. We'll just stuff it in there. Here you go. Go. Yeah, keep going. Here. Hurry. Come on. I tell you what, let's do this. All right, here we go. Take her out. Now let Logan participate now. We gotta let Logan have some fun. All right, here we go. Logan, you take it real easy. Pass it around. Come on, we gotta get it up here. We gotta make it go around. Come on, we gotta do it. Come on, we gotta hurry. Hurry. I'm gonna get your feet from her. All right. There we go. Now, don't tear it. All right, Logan. Here you go, Logan. You take that. I'll take this. We'll pass it around. Go that way. I don't care. We'll go this way. We'll make it up and down and up and down. And that's good. All right. So, you see, it's pretty tough not to tear it because it's real. This is the good stuff, okay? The industrial stuff, it's not going to tear. You don't have to worry about that. So, you can play this game at home. It's real easy. It's real fun to do. Like these guys, you could tell they were having a ball. So anyway, guess who gets to clean the stage up? These two. All right? So you clean it up. All right. So we're going to find a trash can to put it in, okay? I'll go find us a trash can, okay? All right. Thank you, guys. You gonna sing?
Well, I never thought I'd have to follow potty humor. But that's the way it goes around here sometimes. Glad everybody's here and having a lot of fun. We always do in Vacation Bible School. We miss the kids because we like to pick each other and have a lot of fun. Can anybody tell me, we've been going through the wordless book, what color should be next?
Green.
Okay. So we're going to do the green page tonight. Don't tell anybody that you learned this from a little green man. Because if you do, then they're going to come to me, and you know what they're going to say? They're going to say, "Where is your home?" And then I'm going to say, "Well, my home's from out of this world." And then I'm going to have a lot of trouble. But anyway, we come to the green page tonight. And the green page stands for what? Growing as a Christian. So does anybody want to tell me some of the things you can do and grow as a Christian? Okay. Very good. Those are good ways to grow as a Christian, and we're going to look at some of the things that green represents and what it is to grow as a Christian. In the Bible, there's a story, and it tells about a grandmother by the name of Lois, and she had a daughter by the name of Eunice, and they had this is her grandson and her son, his name was Timothy, and Timothy means honoring God. So that is a very good name to have if your name is Timothy. And so they wanted him to honor God, so they taught him the Bible. And that looks a little different from most of the Bibles that we see, because in those days it was written on scrolls that they would roll out. Now, do you study Bible to be able to answer Bible trivia questions? No, you don't. That's the way you learn knowledge. You learn knowledge by learning facts, and then you're able to repeat those facts back. But when you're able to use those facts in a useful way, in a productive way, and you can do something with them, then that turns into wisdom. And the Bible says that he grew in wisdom, and because he grew in wisdom, he wanted to do something with the facts that he had learned. And so God made a way for him to do that.
he sent a man by to see him, and his name was Paul. Paul wrote many of the books in the New Testament, and God used him in a great way. He's probably the greatest missionary of all time. And he came by, and he had heard about this young man's reputation. He's growing up now and becoming a young man. And so I imagine it would be hard for a mama to let her son go away on the missionary field like she was doing. What's her name? Eunice. Okay, and what's his name? Timothy. And what's his name? Okay, we got it all together now. We know who the characters here are. And so Eunice was going to let Timothy go and be a missionary with Paul. And you know what? If you had asked Paul, well, what's your experience been? Wouldn't you want to know that, Sherry? You let your boy go all the way to China, didn't you? Taiwan, to be specific there. And when you did, I'm sure it was hard to let him go. And I'm sure, Heath, that it was hard for you to go. So it was going to be hard. But Sherry, what if you had asked some old guy like me that was going to go over there, and he said, well, sometimes I get shipwrecked. Sometimes they stone me with stones. Sometimes I'm hungry. And you'd start saying, I don't know if I want my son to go with this guy. Well, that's the story that he had to tell, because it was the truth. And Paul had learned that he told the truth, and they let him go. And they let him go because he needed to be a disciple, someone who is sent out to tell the plan of salvation. Just like Miss Kathy and Abby were showing us a while ago, we need to be telling people. And the illustration they used was in the United States, and we call that home missions. And we say when we go outside of the United States, we call that foreign missions. And we should be doing both of those things and telling the plan of salvation to everyone. And that's some of the scriptures we'll learn for this week. Okay, and now I'm going to show you a page, and it's got several things on it, and I'm going to talk to you about this. This lesson's not a long lesson, but it tells you how to grow in grace, really. Grace is the unmerited favor of God, and we are telling the message, the plan of salvation to others. We're doing it here in Vacation Bible School. He did that when he went away to Taiwan, and I tell people Heath is the missionary to Taiwan. I'm the missionary to Redbud. God said, Jerry, you staying home. I don't know exactly why he said to do that, but that's what he did. He told me, he wanted me to stay here. And I said, okay, Lord, I'll do that. And so I did, but some people have to go a much further distance than what I have. I actually got saved about right over here when I was a boy, and here I am probably about 5 or 10 feet away from where I got saved at, so I hadn't been very far. But the plan of salvation gets to go out in many different ways, and God has used that, but you have to be willing to do it. You have to want to do it, and you need to assemble those facts, but you don't want to get puffed up and be able to answer Bible trivia. You want to be able to have useful knowledge that you can pass on to others, and so that's where we need to be. So they said, don't let nobody despise your youth. Why would somebody despise your youth? Well, because you're young, they think you don't know what you're talking about. But many of you are very knowledgeable in the scriptures, and you know how to present the plan of salvation. And if you ask some adults out there, can you present the plan of salvation? They say, I don't know. And the first thing they're going to say is, I'm not worthy. Well, who made me worthy? Who made Brother Wesley worthy? Okay, same person who made Brother Paul worthy and Brother Timothy worthy and Sister Eunice and Sister Lois. Because our sins have been taken away, washed away, and God made us worthy. There's a story in the Bible where God taught that to Peter, and some of you who are Christians know that, so don't tell me you're not worthy to do this. You're indicating that you have to be perfect to do it. And who's perfect? Olivia, who's perfect? Who's never sinned? Only Jesus, right? Not Pawpaw, not Jerry, not Wesley, not Olivia. It is only Jesus. So let's get going here. I'm chasing rabbits again, so I'll get back on here. Don't let anybody despise your youth. In other words, you need to know the Scriptures. Well, if you're going to know the Scriptures, what book do you need to read? Wordless book. I know every word in the wordless book. I bet you know every word in the wordless book. But that's the right answer. That's the right answer. He knows every word in the wordless book. He's got one right there in his hand. Okay. So that's the plan of salvation. And you can share it with somebody, can't you? Yeah, you know it. Okay. And how old are you?
Six.
He's six and he can do it. Adults? Oh, okay. Going to be seven this year. All right. I try to hold my age down. You trying to hold yours up. Okay. Well, anyway, let's look at this and get going here. This book that we need to know is the Bible. And if you're going to have a personal relationship with somebody, you need to know what's in their heart, what's on their mind, what makes them tick, what makes them happy, what makes them sad. You want to know all these things about it. If you want to know those things about Jesus Christ, you need to read that book. And then you need to do what it says and go out and be an evangelist like this, maybe to Redbud like me, maybe to Taiwan, maybe to the world as these men made their way around. Okay, now, one thing you always need to keep at the center of your ministry and what you do is the cross. The cross is where Jesus died. It was a place of sacrifice. Since Jesus died for you, what do you want to do for him? Well, for several years, I wanted to live for him. Okay, and I hope you do too. And while we are living here, we need to be passing on the plan of salvation so others can get saved too. And then we need to have a heart clean from sin. First, we get saved. Our sins are washed away, and that is our position in Christ, to use a big word. In other words, we're saved. We're going to heaven by telling other people about Jesus. Don't get us into heaven any further than what it was before. We're going to heaven. It's a done deal. Our deeds didn't get us saved. Our deeds won't keep us saved. But our deeds show that we do love who? Yeah, Jesus. All right. And because Jesus died on the cross, he paid for our sins on there, then we are to be thankful and appreciative of everything that he has done. Now, if we are Christians, then we are soldiers for Christ. Okay, this soldier is not really meant for this, but let me use a little explanation here. Ephesians 6, 6th chapter and the 12th verse through the 18th verse, says we should put on the helmet of salvation. We need to be saved. Our mind needs to be straightened out. And so to protect our minds, we need to know what the Bible says. So we should have on the helmet of salvation. We should wear the breastplate of righteousness. We should be doing the right things. We should have on the belt of truth. Everything kind of falls apart if you don't have on the belt of truth. I won't get down to that. But anyway, we'll look at this. And the gospel is the gospel of peace. And we should be standing on it. And we say we stand on the rock of Jesus Christ. It's firm ground. If you're a soldier and you lose your footing, you're going to lose your life. And we're going to waste our life. And we're going to be get killed if we're not on solid foundation. And so the gospel of peace will get us there. Okay, he's got a sword here, and that is the sword of the Spirit. And that sword represents the Bible, and that is our only offensive weapon, the only one we can use as an offensive weapon. There is one other that's missing from this soldier. He wasn't really made for this purpose, but it would be a shield of faith. And the Romans had leather on their shield. They'd soak them in water because people would throw fiery darts at them, and that would put it out. And so we need that shield of faith. And So if you want to read about that, you can read about it, as I say, there in that scripture. Now, you should not be a lover of money. If you want to lay up your rewards, lay them up in heaven. Because once you die, 1 minute after you die, your pile of possessions belongs to somebody else. And you're not going to be here on this earth. Where are you going to be? You're going to be with Jesus. Jesus said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So you're going to be in heaven. The only possessions you're going to have is up in heaven. And Jesus says, I'll give you a crown when you do certain things. And you know what we're going to do with our crown once we get up into heaven? We're going to cast them at the feet of Jesus and say, you know, really ought to be yours, shouldn't be mine. You did it all. I know I was there and I got to watch it and be a part of it. I got the joy of doing it, and thank you. Now, this little boy is being a witness to this little girl. What would he tell her? He would tell her the plan of salvation. And when he tells her the plan of salvation, he's telling her scriptures. Now, when we started doing that, we said John 14:2-3 said, in my Father's house are many mansions. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's what that verse says. So we tell people that they need to be going to a place called heaven, and it's a beautiful place. We'd like for them to go, but we've got a problem. And if you'll look at this, this scripture that we find here is for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we said we found that in Romans 3:23. That's the address there. And then Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. It had been predicted that he would die that way, and he did. And if we look in Psalms 22, we'll find where a description of a death on the cross is, and that was predicted by a song David sung many, even thousands of years ago. And then we look here, and it says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. It means forgforgiveness of sin. That's in Hebrews 9:22. Why am I showing you this? To say that all these people that told these things were telling the truth. This comes out of the Bible. You can look up these references if you want to at home. Because, like Brother Wesley said, you can go back and you can binge watch this and see if we told the truth all the way through and stuck to what it said in the Bible. But thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:57. So we get our victory through Jesus. He died on the cross, paid for our sins. In our lesson for last night, I could have finished and said that Jesus said, it is finished. His part was finished. And now our part has come along, and it's time for us to do our part to be a part of this. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, 2 Peter 3:18. And so to be able to grow, we need to know the plan of salvation. All of us need to know it. Those that are lost need to know it so they can be saved. Those that are saved need to know it so they can be obedient and so they can do what God said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And the gospel is the birth, life, death. Slow down, Jerry. The gospel is the birth, the life, the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so these colors represent that. We go to the back of the book, and it is gold. And who knows what gold represents? Heaven, okay. We tell people about that. Last two chapters of the Bible will tell you that, okay. And then what keeps us from going there? Sin. That's right. Y'all are saying it before I do, so that means y'all getting it right. Okay. And then the next color that comes up is God made a way for us to be saved. What was it? Yeah. Yeah. And that shows that his blood was shed for us. So the penalty of sin was paid, because we saw right over there in Hebrews 9:22, without shedding blood, no, there is no forgiveness of sin. Why? Because life is in the blood, and Jesus died for our sins, so the payment was made. We don't have to pay for it. It's already paid for, okay? And once our sins are paid for, they are washed away. And the Bible says, for as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the children of God. Now, let me ask you this. Have you done that? The question is, you can know the facts, but do you have the knowledge? The knowledge is putting those things together and being able to say, I'm saved. I'm cleansed. I have sinned in the past. We need to admit it. Adam wouldn't admit it. But then Jesus come along and he paid the price of our sins because no man could live a perfect life. But if we have our sins cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ or covered, then when God looks at us, he don't see sin anymore. And then we can go and be with God up in heaven. But he didn't zap me out of here when I got saved right over there when I was 10 years old. He left me here on this earth to grow. And part of growing is also telling the plan of salvation. So we go to church, and you know what? Why do you go to church? I've had people tell me, they say, I can serve God at my house just as good as I can in that church where them people are at. Yeah, how many people have you led to Christ at your house? How many times have you had anybody out of your house to go to the mission field? How many times in your house have you gone out? Brother Wesley, what's some things this church does? Would you tell the people, and then would you ask if anybody would like to be saved? And you conclude this.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jerry. We have opportunities, just as we said earlier tonight, to be a part of a body. It's hard to be a part of a body when you're just a body part and you're separated and severed away. I often try to get people to think about how, as a part of a body, if you're a finger or a hand or an elbow or a forearm, all those things need one another. The muscles and the skin and the tendons, we all work together. And to try to be a Christian and just be one of those parts and do that at home, or somebody says, I just live for Jesus, and maybe you do that at the ball field or wherever, and you say, that's just what I do, that's the only thing. Well, you've limited God. And we don't want to limit God. What we want to do is we want to plug into the body of Christ, and that means the other people. Now, I've heard some people say, well, it's the people that get in my way. Well, praise the Lord that our Savior didn't let people get in his way of being our Savior. And we had a great service this past Sunday. It was homecoming. And at the end of the service, Brother Sam Smith reminded us that God is sovereign, which means he's in control, and we can trust him. And the last thing he told us that stuck with me this week is that people matter. And so because God is in control, that's one reason we go to church. Well, that's what God says do. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as is the habit of some people, to say it doesn't matter. But so much more so, we get together, we participate together, because that's what it means to be on God's team, to be a part of God's body. And at this church, we do all kinds of things. Vacation Bible School is a part of being a part of a body. Reaching out to community. I'm having a lot of people ask me, a lot of the children and young people on Wednesdays, we're still delivering meals in the community to some of the children who normally come on our buses. And mamas and daddies and children saying, when are we going to get back to church? Well, the things that we rely on and we're used to and accustomed to, because the church is a body. It takes a whole lot of people. Some people cook and some people deliver and some people teach and some people wrap other people in toilet paper. Isn't that weird? I don't know what kind of spiritual gift that is, but Brian has it. I mean, he can do that. But we have all that kind of fun, leading in music. We have so many people. I told Michael Moore this week, he's our MVP because he's keeping our technology going. He and Rodney have just been like Frankensteining together our computers and things this week. And those things may not ever get on the screen. They may not ever be in the headlines. But it doesn't mean we're not important. We're important in the body of Christ. And so what we want to think about is are we plugged in? And you may be at home somewhere and you say, I believe in Jesus. I'm just not really plugged in to a local church. Well, you may not be in Calhoun. If you are, you're welcome to plug in at Bethesda. We'd love to have you here. But God has a place for everybody. And so we want to encourage you to do that. Now, the Bible tells us once we're saved, we're supposed to declare that publicly. We're supposed to tell people, and then we're supposed to testify of it with our baptism. So somebody who got saved this week may need to be baptized. You need to find a church home, declare that public profession of faith through believer's baptism. You may need to join a church and say, I need to get back involved. There may be moms and grandparents who are at home with their children saying, we need to get involved. Well, in whatever way you can, you do that. I know it's a different, weird time, but God's opening doors of involvement. And churches are trying to recreate and figure out how to do that. And so find one near you and do that. But we want to back all the way up and say, now, we don't ever take for granted that everybody is saved. Never do we want to do that. So right now, as we're ending the service and getting ready to close with our worship and giving, we want to think about whether or not you have ever received Jesus Christ personally for yourself. Now, the Bible tells us that the Apostle Paul had Timothy, and Timothy had a godly mama and a godly grandmother, but Timothy had to receive it for himself. He had to get saved for himself. So hope you had a good upbringing and background. The question is, have you received Jesus for yourself? So I want to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes, and everybody just be real quiet just for a moment, real still, because we wouldn't want to interrupt anybody around us. And Lord, we just ask you to make it real clear and plain in our hearts whether or not we know you and you know us. And Lord, if there's anyone here that does not know you, we pray that even right now, in their heart, maybe out loud with their voice, they say, Lord, I want to know you. I admit to you that I'm a sinner. I recognize my sin has separated me from you, and it will do so forever unless I receive you. God, I know you don't want me to be separated. You love me in spite of my sin, and even though I was still a sinner, you died for me. You could do that because you're God and you're perfect, and you never sinned, not one time, Jesus. You died. You died by willing yourself to die in my place. And Lord, I receive that gift. You gave yourself to me as a free gift. And Lord, I want to receive it. I believe in you. Come into my heart. Save me. Forgive me. Let me be part of your family. Lord, thank you for loving me with an eternal love, an everlasting love. Thank you that you'll never leave me, never forsake me. Jesus, I want to live for you. God, we ask you right now that someone's praying that prayer in their own words, in their own heart, that you're saving souls. God, as we are bowed before you, someone needs to make a decision to come forward, whether it's through sending a message through Facebook or walking across the house and telling someone in the next room, I just got saved. I want everybody to know it. God, give someone that boldness to believe in our heart and confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. And God, you get glory every time that happens. And God, we thank you for what you're doing this week in our lives. Lord, let us live for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And I pray that if you're in this room tonight and you made that decision in your heart and Jesus was speaking to you, that you'll let somebody know it. If you made that decision at home tonight, that you'll let someone know it. I was talking to Brother Michael before church started. He said, Pastor, you keep telling everybody to message us, but our messaging is disabled on our Facebook account. And I'm like, well, that just shows how much I know about Facebook. So I think we have it enabled, Michael says we do. So if you've been trying to message us, I hope there's 10,000 people out there saying we got saved this week and we just haven't heard about it yet. But if you're trying to message us, and there's that many of you, I'll enlist Jerry to help me respond to all those messages. And we would love to communicate with you. And you know what? We joke about that, but if there's one, it's worth it all. And so if you'll message us, let us know how we can help you, whether it's salvation or baptism or church membership or just somebody to pray with you, then we're here for you. We want to thank God that we've been a part of this body, and we want to thank God that he gives us an opportunity to plug in and participate and give. And so we're going to have a time of giving, and we're going to crank up our giving song. And so those that are in the room are going to come, and we're going to have an offering time. And we love to give. Can somebody tell me what our offering is going for this week? Shoeboxes. They go around the world. And we've been not fully around the world, but we've been to some places. and we've talked to them in South Africa and Zambia and other places. They said, we've seen those shoeboxes. They've been in our village. They've been in our community. And that's one way that we participate together for the kingdom of God. So we're going to sing and dance and give all at the same time. And that's one reason I love VBS, is because we can do so many wonderful things. All right. Yes, Jesus is everything you need. And I just want to say thank you to each one of you who've been here every night in the room. We've had a great core group with us helping pull things off. I won't go through all the people who've made it possible. But I do want to say thank you to Sister Delilah, who's mainly behind the scenes every year and this year too. But she leads us, she coordinates, and gets everything together. And we're so excited about Vacation Bible School. Every year we were anxious every night, I think, because it's different, but that just makes us trust the Lord more. And so thank you for your participation. Encourage others, if they've missed any of it, to go back and watch and participate in retrospect. The only thing I really hate tonight is that we do not have smell-o-vision, because if you could smell what's going on in here, you would know that you're going to miss out. We're about to have donuts in a little while. Some of you know that that's one of our traditions at Vacation Bible School, is somebody makes little donut things with powdered sugar on them, and you're going to miss out because you're not here, but we're going to eat some for you, okay? And if you're not here, we're going to eat some on your behalf. But thank you for being here. We're going to close out with our final song one more time, our theme song, Concrete and Cranes, and we would love to invite you to participate weekly with us. We are worshiping on Sunday mornings at 8:15 and 11 in the building, socially distanced. And we are meeting here on Wednesdays right now outside in Bible study groups. And starting this Sunday night, we're going to begin to have evening worship services together in the building and socially distant as well. We'll always continue to have the radio transmission and the Facebook Live services will be there. And so pray for us as we prayerfully re-engage in some of the things that we've done in the past, and we'd love for you to come and be a part of those things with us. So pay attention to our Facebook. It's the best way to keep up with what's going on and the things that are changing day in and day out. So let's do concrete and cranes one more time. Okay, guys? See you next year, hopefully all together and hopefully all inside. Amen. May God bless you and keep you is my prayer for each one of you.